Okay, we're going to continue studying our vector spaces. I'm going to, as always, begin with a little vector space, which I'll call V. The vector space will have four dimensions. It'll be a real vector space, so it has a bucket of real numbers that to draw from. And I'm going to say its basis is E sub mu. So we have four basis vectors, E sub 0, E sub 1, E sub 2, and E sub 3. And these basis vectors are going to be the ones that we're going to use to sort of create structure for this vector space. Now, in the last lecture, we talked about maps. Well, maps have to go from the vector space to somewhere, so we will talk about creating another vector space, which we call W, and W has some unknown number of dimensions. It really doesn't, well, not unknown. You would have to define it very well, but it could have any number of dimensions, so I'll just write any here, and it'll also be a real vector space, and it'll have some basis, f. I'll change the index to f nu, to f nu, like that. So we've created our initial vector space, which is sort of our anchor of thought. It's our domain. The map maps to the range vector space, which is just some other vector space. And we know how to do this. We now know that if I have to just define this mapping for each of the basis vectors, like this. And once I've done this, once I've defined these four values, which could be anything, right? And these four values, of course, are in here, right? These values that I put here are in this vector space somewhere. And once I do that, I know that I can, so I just put something here, I put something here, I put something here, I put something here. And once I've done that, I can then map any vector using the linearity property of the mapping. All these are linear maps, right? These are linear maps. So because of this, once I create this structure here, which is a map and an arbitrary vector, whenever I do an arbitrary vector, you're always going to see me writing it this way. Using the Einstein summation convention, the vector basis here, and the components of the vector here. The components are real numbers drawn from this bin. These are vectors in the space. And so when I do this, I just simply can expand it as A0, lambda map times E0, plus A1 map on E1, A2 times the map on E2 plus A3 times the map on E3. And we now know that these here, these four expressions in the brackets, are how we defined our map, right? That was an arbitrary choice we made. We made a choice on that. This is what tells us how the map works. Then this process here, this multiplication process, is going to be the scalar multiplication in this vector space, right? Because this object here is a member of this vector space, and this addition property is going to be the vector addition property from this vector space. Okay, so that was how these maps worked. There's an interesting issue though. The issue is this: we created this thing, right? And in order to have a map, you have to have sort of a range. You have to have a destination. So in order to have a map, you can't just define a vector space and a map. You seem to have another vector space. And the question is can we get away from that? What if I want a universe that is one vector space, or a mathematical construction of just one vector space? I don't want to create a second vector space, but I still want maps. What can I do in that circumstance? And the answer to that is very, very important, because the answer to that really has to do with what we call the dual space. The first thing is I can imagine getting rid of this thing, right? And now I have a map, and the map has got to go somewhere, and the only place it can go is back into the original vector space. That's one place. And the other place it could possibly go is it could go to this bin of real numbers. And that's the map we care about. We care about this map here, the map between the vector space V and its bin of real numbers. The bin of real numbers, if you think carefully about it, it's a vector space of dimension 1 over the real numbers, and it only has one basis vector, so I don't even get to use a Greek letter. I might as well just use E0. In fact, I don't even need the 0, right? I could just say E. And that is a one-dimensional vector space. And a one-dimensional vector space can be realized by using the real numbers. So the real numbers are a one-dimensional vector space. Its multiplication property is simply real number multiplication. Its addition property is real number addition. And it draws its scalars from the real numbers itself. So it actually is what we call a realization of a one-dimensional vector space. So we're interested now in maps that go from V to R. Why is this important? It's important because we're not adding anything to our universe, right? We've created a vector space, and once we've created a vector space, we've automatically presume the existence of a bin of real numbers. That's part of the definition of a vector space. We don't have to define anything new, and that's really, really important because we're trying to keep this all very minimal, right? We're not defining cross products and dot products and things of that nature. We're sticking with very, very simple things. And the simplest thing we're going to do is we're going to create a vector space, and we're going to create some maps into the real numbers. And this is the process that we're fundamentally interested in. Now, although we've not had to add anything to our universe to create this concept of a mapping, the problem is we still have to actually create the map, right? We still have to decide how this works, how the map works on the basis vectors, right? We have to make that decision. And that is another thing we would have to add. We have to add a map. Well, that's too much. I still don't want to do that. I want something that just exists. Once we create this vector space, everything else logically and automatically follows without me doing anything. And the only way that can work is instead of considering a map, I consider the set of all possible maps. Once I consider the set of all possible maps, I'm not actually adding anything to it. I'm not actually creating anything new. I'm not actually inventing anything. The set of all possible maps is what I would choose from if I were to create a single map. But I'm not going to make the choice. Instead of choosing a single map, lambda, all I'm going to do is take the set of all possible maps. That set of all possible maps is called the dual space. That set of all possible maps is called the dual space of this vector space. If the vector space is V, the set of all possible maps from V into the real numbers is the dual space, and it's called V star. Okay, so we're going to review just a little bit because I want to make sure this is totally clear. I've created V. This is an act of creation. I've created V. I've assigned it a basis. Because V exists and V is a vector space, it has a bin of real numbers. I get a bin of real numbers for free, or I've already built it, I guess. Now, between maps between V and the real numbers, I have to create something. I have to create this map, lambda. And I have to create it by defining its action on each of the basis vectors. So I have to know how lambda acts on each of the basis vectors. I would have to make that assignment. However, if I just agree that I'm going to create a set of all possible maps, I don't have to create an assignment anymore, right? That assignment just exists. All possible maps is something I don't have to add anything to it. It's every single one. I don't have to make these distinctions, right? So once I don't have to do that, I'm actually, as a mathematician, adding nothing to the concept. So this set exists. Now I'm going to call that set, I'm going to call it V star, and that's the dual space, right? That's the dual space. So I'm calling that set the dual space. And I call it a dual space because I'm going to show that the set of all possible maps is, in its own right, a vector space. So what do I have to show? I have to show it has an addition property. I have to show it has a scalar multiplication property, right? And I have to show that for every member, every map, there's something called an opposite map. And if you add those two together, you get zero, right? Now, I could go through this in great detail. It's done in lots of books. But the idea is we have to define an addition property. So let's do that. We'll define an addition property between lambda and, zeta, or big Z, right? These are two maps. These are two maps that are a member of the dual space, right? So how do I define the sum of two maps? Well, I'm going to define it this way. The sum of two maps is some map that acts on a vector such that it equals the obvious linear, what you would expect for two linear maps to do, right? If I take the sum of two maps and act on a vector, I should get the same thing as if I take the two maps, act on the vector, and then take the sum. This, by the way, of course, is a real number, right? Because this is a map between the vector space and the real numbers. So this is real addition here. This is the addition I'm defining right now, right? So I've defined that. I can also define the I can define a scalar multiple of a map acting on V is the same as the map acting on V multiplied by a real number. Where here now, I'm using the scalar multiplication property from the real numbers, which is a vector space, right? This is a dimension one vector space, so it has a real multiplication property. I'm using it here. This is a real number because that's how the map works. It takes vectors and gives you real numbers. So this map is defined through this expression. So now I've defined addition, I've defined scale and multiplication, and now I'm just going to say, look, scale and multiplication by negative 1 gives you the opposite map, and therefore 0 is a 0 map, which means every vector here gets mapped to 0, right? So because of this, now I know that the set of all possible maps, or the dual space, is a vector space. So the reason this is so important is, in some sense, I cannot just create a single vector space. If I try to create a single vector space, right, like this, I've already automatically created, without adding anything else, I've created a dual space, which is also going to be the same number of dimensions, and it's going to have its own basis. The basis of the dual vectors we're going to talk about in a moment, but those basis vectors are going to be symbolized with an upper superscript, with a superscript. So basis vectors from the normal space is going to have a subscript. Basis vectors from the dual space is going to have a superscript. How do I choose these? Well, it's arbitrary, as usual. However, I'm going to just prefer the fact that I would like to know about maps. Remember, these are maps. Each one of these little members of this vector space is a map. So I want a map called E0, and I want E0 when it acts on the basis vector E0 from this space, I want that to be 1. I want the map E1 to when it acts on the basis vector E1 from the original space to give me 1. But I want the map E2, when it acts on E2, to give me the number 1. And I want the basis vector of the dual space E3, when it acts on E3, to give me 1. Understand, these things are members of the dual space. The dual space are maps, and I'm now defining this map as the map that takes E0 to 1, E1. This map, E superscript 1, takes the basis vector E subscript 1 from the vector space to 1. This map acts on this vector to give you 1. This map, E3, acts on this basis vector to give you 1. And also what's important is that E0, when it acts on E1, should give you 0. Likewise, E for E2. Likewise for E3. It should always give you 0. The only thing that this map returns is 1 if it acts on the basis vector E0. And the way we write that out, of course, if you can almost see it coming, E mu, E nu equals delta mu nu. Now, an important thing to understand is this is just convenience. I like the numbers 1, right? I like the fact that I can sort of separate these things out because I can imagine how this might help me do some calculations in the future. But this choice of basis compared to this, this is called the dual basis, by the way. This is the dual basis. My choice of dual basis is completely arbitrary. This basis is no more legitimate than any other basis here, just as this basis is no more legitimate here. And the fact that this basis is related to that basis through this rule is just because I like the rule. This is a very arbitrary fact. And the reason I'm saying that is because it's very important to understand that despite the fact that this vector space comes for free, once you create this, there is no canonical way of correlating vectors from one to the other. There's no automatic mapping that is naturally tells you which dual vector belongs to which vector. That doesn't exist. There's no such mapping. It's, remember, these are all possible maps from this to the real numbers. This is all possible vectors. All I'm saying is that all possible maps exist. And you know what? I'm going to pick out a basis and I'm going to make that basis follow this rule. But that's just me. That's just random convenience. All right. It's very important to understand there's no fundamental correspondence between these, despite the fact we've created a dual basis. Okay, so next time we're going to go into this a little bit deeper and discuss some of the important properties of the dual space.